Good afternoon. We've been having super return conferences now since 1998, 20 years. George pointed out earlier that 20 years ago, 80 people turned up in Holland for super return. And I think in part that was because it was the Queen's birthday in Holland. But today we have over 2,200 people here. And over that same time, what was once a cottage industry has now grown into something with assets under management of over $4.7 trillion. We've got a great group of people together today. Each of the people on this panel have been in the industry for over 20 years. Funny enough, we've known each other for about 20 years. George, Helen, Kata, they've all been entrepreneurs, business builders, investors, industry leaders, and over that time we've done some partnership work together and become friends. So I'm very pleased to be able to interview them today. So George, you want to introduce yourself a little bit and talk about how you got into the industry and how long you've been
at it? Sure, Craig. Well, for those of you who don't know me, my name's George Anson. I'm a managing director at HarbourVest Partners. I'm Canadian by birth. My mother's Canadian, my father's English. I grew up in the United States and moved to the UK in 1984, which is where I've lived ever since. And I've actually had two jobs in my entire career, one beginning in 1984, where I worked at a firm that is the precursor to what is now Pantheon Ventures, and in 1990 I joined Hancock Venture Partners to open their London office, and that business is now known as HarbourVest Partners. I've been working in the asset class of private equity now for 33 years, and I'll talk later about the things that we've seen over those last three decades.
Helen?
Great, thanks, Craig. Yeah. So my name's Helen Steers. I'm a partner at Pantheon. I've been with Pantheon since 2004, and prior to that, I was with a large asset manager, running their European fund of funds business in Paris. And prior to that, actually, I was in Canada, so I'm an adopted Canadian. I moved over to Canada having done my engineering degree to do an MBA in Canada. And ended up staying a little bit longer than I thought I would. So started my career actually in private equity 27 years ago as a direct investment manager at a Canadian bank doing direct deals. And then I moved to the Caisse de dépôt et placement du Québec in Montreal, where I sort of sat more in Kata's position actually, investing the Caisse's assets in European private equity, and then moved into the fund investment field. So it's been a while in the industry. I think I first started coming to Super Return probably in 2001 when it was in Munich. So that was my first time.
And good afternoon. My name is Kata Salovaara. I'm Finnish. I studied economics at the University of Helsinki, and after that ended up working in London. And that's when I stumbled across this cottage industry, private equity. And so I started in the European investment team at Pantheon, in fact. And then I worked with the Shell UK Pension Fund on the PE side, and in 2000 I moved back to Finland to set up a private equity program at Ilmarinen, which is a Finnish pension insurance company. So my first 20 years in private equity have been a great journey, because I really enjoy investing with this mission of providing for people's future, and it's been a great journey, lots to do. I mean, when I started, we had less than 100 million in the asset class, and today we have 6%, so 2.2 billion invested in private equity.
Terrific. Well, thanks very much for that. So let's start by talking about how we got to where we are in this industry and where we might be headed. In broad terms, George, perhaps you can give us a few observations.
Sure, Craig. well, is one of the things I hope we learn from this is learning from history. And as Winston Churchill said, the farther back you can look, the farther forward you're likely to see. Or as Mark Twain also commented, history doesn't repeat itself, but it does rhyme. And so with that in mind, Craig asked me to sort of think about over the last 20, 25 years that I've been in the private equity industry, you know, what have we seen that's changed quite dramatically, what for the good and not so good, and also what has stayed the same? And a couple of observations. Firstly, when I started with what is now Hancock or HarbourVest Partners in 1990, there were probably five or six competitors. Pantheon, UBS Brinson, Chancellor, Horsley Bridge, and Crossroads. And if we managed between all five or six of us $3 billion, that was a lot of money back then. Today, there's well over 100 of our peers in the industry today. And if that's a proxy for the growth of the private equity industry, then I think that gives you a sense of how much it's grown, the explosion of AUM, but also the increase that we've seen in investment opportunities, both geographically, globally, but also in the spread and the mix of things that we can invest in, whether it's secondaries or co-invest or other types of structured products. What's gone along with that as well has been an increase in regulation, where, not surprisingly, governments have been much more interested in what the private equity world is doing. And so we shouldn't be surprised that things like the AIFMD have come into being, and that organizations like the BVCA or Invest Europe now have turned from being a talking shop about co-investments to really becoming an advocacy organization for the industry. One of the things that's also changed has been communication. And if when I started, we didn't have the internet, we didn't have mobile phones, what I had was the postman, and I had my landline sitting on my desk. And the way in which we looked at investment opportunities was whatever arrived in my inbox that day. And the challenge for every GP coming in to talk to us was how to get their offering memorandum or PPM from the bottom of the stack to the top of the stack. And that's literally how our business operated. And when we communicated, if we didn't do it by telephone, it was by letters. And most of the people in my organization were working on that basis, that we'd either write letters or make telephone calls. And I'll get back to that in just a second here. The last point I wanted to make, though, that what hasn't changed in the industry in all the years that I've been working here has been the time it takes to travel. With the possible exception of the Eurotunnel and Eurostar, it still takes just as long to fly from London to New York or Hong Kong as it did 30 years ago. And in fact, in some cases, it might have even taken longer today with all the security procedures and precautions that we have to take. But the last point I wanted to make here, the one thing that's changed has been when I started out in the industry, there were very, very few women. And the ones, frankly, that were in our office were the ones that took dictation or listened to my dictaphone and typed up the letters for me. But I think that's changing or will change, hopefully, in the future. And Helen, you wanted to say a few words in that regard.
Yeah, no, I think it's interesting in that I think it's also indicative of the way that the industry has changed and evolved. At the moment, we still don't have enough women in senior positions in private equity. It's around 5%, according to the Invest Europe statistics. We need to get more women into the industry at the early stage, maybe recruiting from a bigger pool. And I think that will be good for the industry in general, because as you say, it's evolved a great deal over time. The sort of skills you need to succeed in the industry today is not just being a spreadsheet monkey. It's not just coming from an investment bank and knowing how to do Excel spreadsheets and interpret the data. It's just so much wider. And I think we can afford as an industry to make a more a bigger effort, actually, to get a more diverse workspace.
So Helen and Katja, the women on this panel have been successful for a long period of time in an industry that has been more heavily populated by men. Research suggests that firms, committees, and teams with senior women do better. And yet, how do we, I think one of the issues is how we get more women into the system, right? How do you get more to apply? And do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose I should start off by saying that, I started life as an engineer, and I can tell you that there are even fewer women in engineering, and that probably hasn't changed very much either. And actually coming into private equity was probably a little bit better than the engineering field. At least I didn't get Swarfiga put into my protective boots like I did when I was an engineering apprentice, which was quite painful anyway. But I think there is a great deal that we can do actually at the entry level, as I was mentioning. I think that often you get interview panels, people that are trying to bring people into the industry that really recruit in their own image. And that's not just good, it's bad from a gender diversity standpoint, but it's also bad from a skills standpoint, because as I was mentioning earlier, I think we need a much broader range of skills in this business. You need people that have got other sorts of experiences, maybe industrial experiences, digitization. Now it's something that we use in every single business, actually, around private equity. And then once you have women or a more diverse workforce coming into the business, you need to be able to support, retain, and promote women and promote a more diverse workforce. And I think that actually that will be very good, as you mentioned, Craig, for the performance of the industry, and actually also good for the image of the industry, a more inclusive industry.
I mean, offline, we've often talked through our relationships about diversity in general in teams, right? Different personality traits, skill sets, preferences, with shared goals and values, and clearly women play a huge part in that. Katja, I was just curious, what was it that inspired you to get into the industry?
Well, it was coincidence, it was really serendipitous, but I think for me, what really got me interested when I stumbled across this industry is that it's really the long-term nature and the value creation aspect. So since I wanted to work in finance, I think that is really what appealed to me, the value creation and what managers, the active ownership, what they do with the companies. So I think this is the appeal that stays.
I think it's the creation of value actually all the way along the chain. So creating value at the company level, but also clearly for your investors. I mean, for your pensioners, for the people that invest with George and I at HarbourVest and at Pantheon, it's extremely key. And I think what's really interesting about this business is the way that it's changed a lot, as you said, over the years. It's become much more data rich. There's a lot you can do with slicing and dicing and all the rest of it. But it's still very much a judgment business. So what I really enjoy actually is not just the quantitative side, but also the qualitative side. The fact that it's still very much about projecting into the future, trying to use clues from the past. So it's all that sort of left brain as well as right brain stuff, I think, which makes it such a satisfying and interesting place.
Exactly, and a people business. So that's why it's also, I think, it has appealed to women.
Craig, I might add to that. I mean, part of the answer is in the title, which is it's private equity. Mm. There is plenty of publicly available data and information, but nothing like you see in the public markets. And so much of that private part of the equity analysis here is down to people and the way in which they present. And if it's going to carry on this way, I don't see that changing much, because I still think that who you are, what you represent, how you're going to execute, what your USP is as much about how you communicate that to your investors and the reputation that comes in the door with you that will matter in their making their investment judgment.
So I think that we all talked a fair bit before this, and it's that ability to get as much information, that ability to have a more controlling impact on your outcomes in this industry that really attracted all of us to it. George, you just raised an interesting point in that's one of the things that stayed the same between public and private equity is the ability to affect more change within the companies you invest in, the ability to do more research before making those investments. But I want to bring this back to growth, and let's think about the growth in the industry. Throughout this conference, through the reports that we've seen, private equity growth in fundraising, assets under management, proliferation of more and more firms, and so forth, it seems to be just on a steamroller here. Everyone projects this is going to keep going, but for how long? George, we talked earlier about the effect on returns as the industry grows. Do you see unbridled growth, or what do you think could potentially slow that down, or create a short-term slowdown?
Sure. And some of these things have to be perhaps probability weighted, but one of the things that I conjectured was that let's just say for the next 5 years that public equities outperform private equity. Give it a 25-30% probability. How much will that change investors' behavior and the attitudes that they have towards investing in alternatives as a rule? Because let's face it, the cost, the friction, the agency cost, whatever you want to call it, of investing into this asset class is high. And if you have then data, and most people are data driven here, particularly the consultants, that suggests that public equities will outperform or do better than private equity and based on recent history, then I could see that and I give it a 25-30% probability, perhaps putting the brakes on the growth. I'm not saying it's going to cause it to decline. Do I think it'll happen? Probably not. But I do also feel that we're narrowing the gap that has persisted for a very long time between the returns that we see from private equity, venture capital alternatives, and public equities. And part of that, the solution to this, is then being able to communicate with investors about what they should expect from private equity going forward than what they've seen in the past.
And I don't know, Helen or Kata, if you want to comment on this, but if that gap narrows to a certain point, would you think the industry will make lower allocations based on a waning gap, given the higher frictional costs that George talks about, and given the perception of illiquidity, although secondaries and cash flow has been improving in the industry for a long time? At what point will investors start to change their allocation to the asset class?
I think if you look historically, this sort of margin of outperformance over public equities has waxed and waned over time. But if you look at a 10-year period, it's been actually quite consistent, and particularly if you have a well-diversified program. So as long as you're not putting all your money in one place at one time, one manager, it's obviously a dangerous strategy, provided you've got a well-diversified portfolio and you're investing in a measured way, you're not trying to second-guess the right vintage years, you're doing the sort of steady deployment. My supposition actually is that private equity will keep on outperforming, and it will do that really because of some of the inherent advantages of private equity, which we all know about, the alignment of interest, the sort of super active ownership, which is the hallmark of private equity. I think in a way what you're asking, Craig, is about the scaling of the industry though, because if we keep getting more money into the industry, and in the last 10 years, the top 100 GPs have raised $1.5 trillion, of which about half a trillion, so $500 billion, is still uninvested, and that's part of that $850 billion dry powder that everybody quotes. So I suppose the big challenge for the industry is the scaling. And Katia mentioned earlier about a cottage industry. We started as a cottage industry. We've been getting more and more institutionalized. Have we got institutionalized to the point where we can absorb more and more capital? I think that's a great comment.
Also, there's so much choice now that we still talk about it like it's one industry, but there's so many different types and so much choice, geography, manager type of investment that I think it's and shapes of LPs as well are very different types of LPs. So I think it's almost like you're having your own version of private equity versus more of a plain vanilla model before. So I think that's why the answer very much depends, and also it might depend by sort of sub strategy as well, because you might actually require a higher premium for holding the least liquid strategies in the space.
It's a pretty innovative industry, and across almost any time measure, private equity has been, well-executed private equity has been unassailably the best performing asset class. And as it's matured, it's found new ways to continue that through the more mature ways we prosecute the investment strategy to the new geographies and product types. You're right, Helen, more money continues to flow in. That's because allocations are increasing for pension funds and other groups to either satisfy their liabilities or to continue making absolute returns. Do you think that this can continue, and do you think that private equity will be twice the size in a pension portfolio in 10 years than it is today, or do you think it'll level out?
Well, I think if you look at percentage of private equity as percentage of GDP, it's still relatively low. Even in the most advanced economies, it's 1.5-2% in the US, something like that. And there's still many parts of the investment universe that you can only get to through private equity, a bit like Heineken, the beer that can get to the parts others can't reach. Right. So private equity but actually particularly in parts of Europe, in emerging markets, it is a way to tap into investment opportunities that don't exist through the public market. So I'm a firm believer that there's still many more opportunities. And I do agree with the point that that the managers are evolving to basically be able to address this opportunity. And I think also this is the ultimate sort of Darwinian type industry as well. I mean, the managers that don't do so well do end up, I mean, it takes quite a while, but they do end up fading and dying. So it's quite a Darwinist type industry too. Mm-hmm.
So Helen, let me just ask you to kind of expand on that. So over the 20 years that we prepared for before we sat down, we've seen a lot of firms come and go. We've seen some firms wax and wane and then recover. And we've seen a handful of firms continue to grow and expand and go from strength to strength. Do you want to talk a little bit about the manager life cycle? And then, if you wouldn't mind, the rest of you also interject on the types of people that are required in the past and today and going forward in the industry.
I think it's quite interesting to talk about the manager life cycle at this point in the cycle, because we've had 7 or 8 terrific years, good returns, lots of distributions, money coming back. And obviously that's made us as investors very happy, but also it's given quite a lot of confidence to GPs, and it's meant that there've been more spin-out groups and emerging managers. So we've done quite a bit of work on sort of what are really the predictors of success at different parts of the manager life cycle. And at the early part of the life cycle, where you've got these emerging managers, spin-outs, or new groups coming together, certain factors are clearly really important. You know, the entrepreneurship, the building of the team, putting processes in place, being able to tap into deal flow because you can't rely on your old portfolio to generate those deals. So there's all sorts of challenges, but also opportunities in those sort of early stages. Then you get to the growth stage in the life cycle, and that's usually where you're in a kind of a bit of a sweet spot. You raise 1 or 2 funds, things seem to be going really well. But then managers often hit kind of the prime area, and sure. Either they look very carefully at themselves and they decide what to do about succession planning and what to do about sort of regenerating themselves. They also take a good look at the environment around them and see whether they need to change in order to be successful in the future. And either they are very good at being a little bit paranoid, actually, and trying to work out if they're still going to be successful in the future, or else they disregard it and all the money and the successes go to their head. And we've seen it so many times that although the returns have looked good in the past, the manager's not able to repeat that in the future, and they fall off the...
So for each of you, then, when you're looking at funds, you're obviously looking at track record, you're looking at return attribution, you're looking at how they prosecuted their investment strategy. But do you think the industry is looking forward enough at their managers? And is enough of the diligence slated toward how well that manager is poised to deliver going forward?
Well, we certainly pay a lot of attention to culture and that type of culture, that really commitment to an enduring culture, so that you're trying to leave the firm in better shape than when you got there, and I think there's a lot of factors that we can look at there qualitatively to assess success factors that are in the culture and also in the investment philosophy, of course.
And I'd entirely agree. there's lots of work that's been done on performance templates and due diligence questionnaires. That's all valuable information, but in a way, all that does is it just makes sure there aren't any questions that you haven't forgotten to ask in the process. Mm-hmm. It's still so important about the evaluation of the USP of the firm that's coming and talking to you, and how they manage the firm, how they communicate, not just externally with their investors, but internally with their team about what they are trying to achieve and where they want to take the firm and where they want to go. And if you look, I'm sure we've got lots of horror stories that we can tell about firms that didn't succeed. I think it's oftentimes it comes down to those simple things, which is about communication, lack of communication, hubris, the belief that that things will never change, that we will just power ahead. And if I was going to add one other thing, it's slightly glib, is that unfortunately, particularly in Europe, the firms that I've seen that haven't done very well are those that put their name on the door. name of the senior partners on the door. And I think that's something to think about here. If you want to create an enduring business model, how do you deal with succession? Unfortunately, none of us live forever. Putting your name on the door instantly sets you up for issues with succession, because who wants to take on the next name, and unless, of course, it's your son, and then you're dealing with nepotism.
Well, then it's a dynasty.
Or daughter, excuse me.
Yes, I was going to say.
So what I'm hearing here is we're talking about engagement levels, right? I mean, it's a big thing, and HBS always talks about engagement being the number one predictor of success in professional services firms. And private equity is an investment business, but still has some attributes of professional services.
And Craig, I would just add that I think that that having loads of data, and George, you talked earlier about how much more data we have now, and that's fantastic, and we can all do lots of slicing and dicing. But if you lose the wood for the trees, if you can't step back at some point and make that assessment and have your antenna out for the human element, then I don't think you'll be a good investor. You need to have both sides.
Do you feel that the three of you? Do you feel that you can find that, identify that, try to quantify that in some way when you're doing manager diligence? And you assess the management team, not just in their past ability, but how well they're working together and how engaged you feel they'll be to deliver in the forward.
It's the hardest thing, Craig. Yeah. I mean, it's
but that's the thing.
But that's the thing, exactly. Yeah. And it's doing it at different levels. It's obviously talking to the most senior people, but also the people below. It's sending your analysts out to have a beer with their analysts. I mean, there's all sorts of things you can do. But I think one thing that I've sort of put my finger on, what makes a firm successful, I think it's this sort of constructive paranoia. People that are never absolutely satisfied. It probably makes them less happy people, but on the other hand, it makes us happier investors.
Mm-hmm. Katya, I just we've known each other a long time, and the same with you, Helen and George. I would say for the three of you, you've always balanced the facts and the data with quite a healthy balance of human interaction throughout the potential investee organization, and that's something that I think is not as common in the industry now. Katya, do you has the way that you've looked at managers changed over the years?
Well, clearly, I mean, our approach has evolved in line with what we've seen as the evolution in the industry. So we've had to evolve and adapt, and we've always looked to build long-term good relationships with managers, but the way we have primarily evolved as well and gotten to know our managers even better is also by co-investing with them. But I think you have to anyhow spend a lot of time with managers to get to know them, so getting to all the qualitative and cultural aspects and dynamics of the firms. So I think that's very important, but we have clearly evolved, and with the co-invest, I think we have even better lens to assessing managers.
I'd agree with that. I think that co-investment, where you're truly co-investment, you're not competing with the managers for the deals, but you are going alongside the managers. It enables you to work with different deal teams, and it enables you to work with the more junior people in the organization as well as the more senior. So you can, build up a bigger picture of what's going on. And I also think that it enables you to do more sort of continuous due diligence rather than it being a snapshot every 3 years or 4 years as it probably was at the beginning of the industry. I think that nowadays it's continuous assessment, really.
I agree.
And you're always making judgments and assessing them.
But if I just add to that, I think as you get older, the tendency is to fall into a certain pattern, and I continually challenge myself to think differently. And for instance, we had this conversation about the millennial generation. My children are old enough now to be in that, and they think differently about their work-life balance, what it means to be successful, where they get their information from, the cues that tell them that they are a success in life and in society. And if we're talking about what's going to happen next in the future, I think we all, as the older generation, have to be sensitized to that. We can't just say, well, that's the way we've always done it, and therefore that's the way it's going to be done in the future. I think we run a real danger and a risk to our own business models if we can't anticipate that the next generation do think and act differently than we have.
And do you think that businesses can successfully, you know, businesses led by a different generation, informed by different values, habits, and success patterns, do you think that they are poised to be able to create ongoing business, you know, improvement with a culture that thinks of things quite differently? Or do you think those cultures will, you know, assimilate into the firms that they're in?
Well, it's the market they're going to serve, yeah, right? So it's their peers. But standing still is not the answer. And one of the things that, you know, excites me about coming to work every day still after 33 years is that there's something different going on. You know, if this is all about data analytics and looking at spreadsheets and screens all day, I would have retired a long time ago, or I'd be off digging in the garden or whatever. Mm. But no, this is great because it's still a people business, it's a judgment business, and it's also anticipating what the next changes of direction are going to be, if you can, and trying to get it at least 60% right. Mm.
So on that, going back to the return, so the return attributions have changed, whether it be, you know, at times in this industry from leverage or multiple expansion or growth. That also, that the types of people that have driven the businesses forward have changed. And it continued to change from when the industry was developing from a cottage industry to something where it was, say, 10 or 5 or even 3 years ago. You know, entrepreneurs, business builders, creators of strategy and process. And now, you know, these things, as the industry gets more competitive, you have to be less volatile, you have to be more precise about your execution. And so people are coming in to improve those areas of a firm. Have you guys found, through your diligence, a different type of person leading firms, and do you expect to see different types of people driving this industry forward?
Well, I think the industry has got broader, because to start with, as I mentioned earlier, it was very sort of numbers, it was very sort of banking driven, to be honest, and it was really all about, you know, buying not very expensively, cheaper than the public markets, you know, putting leverage on the companies, and then trying to sort of sell it on. And I think these days, everybody's got those tools. Everybody understands how to put effective and efficient capital structures in place. You know, the bankers will come and tell you how to do it as well. So it's all you know, really really kind of shaved to perfection. And then, you know, the people that can process data. A lot of those people around. There's all sorts of automated programs as well these days that can do a lot of that for you. So I think now all the value add is really coming in from people that know a great deal more, not just about sectors, but about subsectors, about microsectors, about the way they're going to get affected by different types of macroeconomic and political events. And it takes people with that sort of skill, but also the operational skill, to be able to go into the businesses and really help them anticipate some of those changes and grow and take advantage of them. So nowadays, I'm coming up to the question, looking at the GPs, I see a much broader mix of skills in the GPs. It comes back to the, you know, the women in private equity level 20 type questions. I think that many of those skills are skills that women can usefully bring. They've been out in industry, and they've got some portfolio management skills as well, which are you know, you need a lot of these days. So yeah, much broader, you know, much more effective, more value creation.
So I'm inferring that you're somewhat positive about the way private equity firms have evolved as managers to tackle the evolving industry. Would you say that's pretty consistent across the board within your portfolios, or do you see a lot of variance there?
It's a spectrum.
Spectrum. Yeah. How wide is that spectrum, Helen?
It's as wide as the dispersion in returns.
Okay. George, would you agree with that?
Yeah, but I would agree with Helen that there's a lot of domain expertise now in every single group that you evaluate. Gone are the days when you have a generalist private equity firm or somebody who just wants to buy things that are cheap. You know, everybody has every quality firm has incredibly talented people with lots of operational experience. And you know, my off the cuff comment is I wouldn't stand a chance today because, you know, I don't have an MBA. I went to a, you know, middling university. I don't speak 3 languages. You know, I wouldn't get past the first screen on the CV thing with a recruiter. That's good.
But, George, you did survive and prosper in the environment that you were in.
And it's the ultimate apprenticeship business, isn't it?
Really? But it is. Yeah. That's true.
Yeah. You can't package that experience and put it in a box.
You can get an MBA in private equity, but it doesn't get you into private equity.
that's true. Hey, guys. Go ahead.
One more thing on the skills side. So, you know, the sector knowledge, the value creation. But something I think GPs have got better at is portfolio management. So I used to see very, very big spreads between the gross and the net. And I think that GPs have got a lot more astute about managing that. So I think that's been a change because they've realized that we don't want the gross IRRs. We want the net IRRs and net multiples.
So
that's important.
With all this talent up here, I would like to take advantage of that by doing a few kind of rapid fire, kind of very short, few word questions with you. Yeah. So just one thing, is there any about the industry that either keeps you awake or you're a little bit worried about in the future that would derail this nice forward progress and evolution?
Oh, easy. It's reputation. Without a doubt, you know, that there's a continuing political slant against private equity and the wealth that private equity managers accumulate. What they don't see is the other side of the coin, which is, and this is where I think the industry can do so much more to mitigate this, is how many jobs that private equity creates or secures, how much it contributes to economic growth in any national regime, and also how much taxation the companies themselves that they invest in through payroll taxes, corporation tax, even the tax the people that get carried interest pay. Because I think if you can get all those three things down and get them measured, then I think every politician in the land will be happy to have private equity as a major contributor to the economy.
Okay, agree with
that. And the returns, I mean, it's providing for the beneficiaries. I couldn't agree more about this. This PR is something that everybody probably can contribute more to, and organizations we have already and so forth, because this is a very valuable industry, but the image is not really in line with what it does.
Associations do a great, I agree as well, but I think the industry associations do a great deal, but ultimately it's the obligation of all of us actually to contribute to that and make sure that we get the good stories out there and you know, we try and get the stories across. And I think the point about the pensioners, the savers and the beneficiaries is one that often gets lost because it's sort of the least sexy bit of it. You know, everybody likes talking about jobs created and fantastic growth companies and technology, but people forget that in order to get that boost in returns for pensioners, you know, you need alternative investments.
There's a
big difference between the, you know, DB schemes and DC schemes in terms of the return they provide for their beneficiaries. And one of the key differences is the fact that DB schemes can do private equity and DC schemes can't at the moment. Mm-hmm.
But that will potentially change and evolve. So do you think that private equity will continue to outperform other asset classes over the next 10 years?
Is that a yes or no question?
That is a yes or no. No, it's a yes or no.
I think yes, but by less.
Okay. Helen?
I think yes, and it'll still be 300 to 500 basis points, but it'll change maybe according to the cycle.
Is this really a yes or no question?
On the spot. Okay. Is there anything that you guys see that's left under-addressed or perhaps slightly ignored currently in the private equity industry? Any segments, any geography, any stage that you think you're looking for some more exposure to?
I'd love to say yes. Mm-hmm. But I can't think of anything right now. You know, the what is out there seems, I'm sure there'll be other ideas that come across, and that's what I'm waiting for, is that next big idea to come across our desk or through the internet.
But nothing in the existing segment, the lower mid-market, a certain region that you feel is an outstanding opportunity?
We all invest in a quite a broad manner, actually, and we're all globally diversified. Mm. And I think actually it's probably not the right thing to sort of pinpoint a particular sector or geography, actually. I think that you need to have this.
Absolutely. Balance. You want to be diversified. Yeah. I was just wondering if you think the industry is doing a good job of giving you, the investor, exposure to all the areas you're interested in.
I did think of one thing. It's slightly tangential. Besides what's going on with level 20, which I think is absolutely right, I think, particularly outside of Europe, more can be done on the ESG front. Because, again, coming back to what pension funds, institutional investors want, that's very much on their agenda. Europe's leading the way. I think other geographies are still catching up. And pretty soon, I think private equity managers will sort of avoid or ignore this topic at their peril.
And also, maybe I agree with you, George, and I think that also seeing it as a way of enhancing value rather than as something you've got to do in order to satisfy your investors and keep your nose clean.
Correct.
Yeah. I think, you know, as a route to value. Mm-hmm. And I think actually there will be some interesting ways, maybe to your point, Craig, to dig into the industry and find some subsectors that maybe have been ignored, maybe on the environmental side that we haven't touched yet.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think we are winding down on available time. One of the things that we all wanted to say was just a quick congratulations to Michaela Virtue, because it often goes unrecognized that she, for nearly 20 years, has continually improved and continually developed and grown this conference into one of, if not the leading alternatives conference. And she's consistently been terrific for all of us. So thanks to her.
You're here.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good.